where the holes have been put in is the external auditory meatus. There's something known as the internal auditory meatus, which is exactly in a straight line. So if you look at this, then something straight is the internal auditory meatus. And from the internal auditory meatus, what is there in the internal auditory meatus? The auditory nerve, or the vestibulocochlear nerve, which is the eighth cranial nerve. After the internal auditory meatus comes in a central auditory pathway. So whatever has been represented here is the central auditory pathway. So we have a mnemonic to remember the central auditory pathway. It is known as
CNS limbica.
CNS limbica. C, N is cochlear nucleus, S is superior auditory complex, L is lateral meniscus, I is inferior polygonus, M is medial genitourinary body, and there is a auditory cortex, which is after the auditory radiations which are put on here. There is the ascending pathway, there is a descending pathway which lands out from the cortical areas, comes to the inferior polygonus, then comes down to the superior auditory complex, then goes down to the cochlear nucleus, and finally to the where? To the medial ear, stapedius. Okay. So this is the ascending and the descending pathway. Today we are going to discuss about the cochlear nucleus, which is the first part. Okay, cochlear nucleus. So here, the brief is done. The cochlear nucleus, the location is at the pontomedullary junction. Yeah? Just as the auditory nerve exits the internal auditory meatus, correct? It joins the cochlear nucleus. It's in the junction of the pons and the medulla, and is known as the pontomedullary junction. It's important to be learned out. The auditory nerve exits the internal auditory meatus, then okay, brain comes out. We have the cortex, the brainstem. In the brainstem, we have the midbrain inside, pons and medulla. The pons is coded out in orange and the medulla in the peach color. So the medulla and the pons, the pontomedullary junction, have the cochlear nucleus. The sections, there are two sections. One is known as the dorsal cochlear nucleus and the other is known as the ventral cochlear nucleus, DCN, BCN. These are made up of a set of cell types. These cell types are known as giant cells, pyramidal cells, octopus cells, stellate cells, spherical cells, multipolar cells, and globular cells. These are the cells mix of the DCN and the BCN, where these cells are located as shown here. We know the entire auditory system is tonotopically organized, which means that there is a certain frequency representation in a particular part. The cochlear nucleus is also tonotopically organized out. To remember, the low frequencies are ventrolaterally located, which means what? Ventro means towards the front, latero means towards the away from the midline. So ventro is front and latero is away from the midline. So low frequency would be this side, while the high frequencies would be dorsomedially. That means low frequencies are here, then high frequencies would be towards the back and towards the midline. Clear? The next part, what is the function of it? See, we are interested about how cochlear nucleus contributes out to the audition. You people are hearing me, right? You people are hearing me, and by common sense, if you take in, then each nerve should be responding out to each cycle of sound. But that doesn't happen, because beyond a particular number of cycles, let's say beyond 100-150, a particular nerve would be fatigued. So to avoid out fatiguing, a bunch of nerves respond to a particular phase. That means every fifth phase, one particular nerve will fire. The rest would be firing at 10th phase. This way a group of nerves get phase logged to respond out to the wide frequency range which we are hearing. That's the first thing. The second thing is me speaking, you speaking, and somebody else speaking could be having some differences. So there is a spectral difference, but there is a spectral similarity. So every time you hear a new person, it is not that you are fumbling out with it. You can make sense of what the person is saying. The concept of allophones and phonemes. The phoneme pho may not be produced out similarly by all of you. So allophone is a reality. Linguistics you must have learned out that. But how do you understand that these allophones actually represent a particular phoneme? Because the spectral properties are similar. So about the phase or the time and the spectral properties, important informations are processed out at the level of the cochlear nucleus, correct? DCN and PCN. Pathology. Now the cochlear nucleus is something which is the first thing after the auditory nerve. It's the first thing after the auditory nerve. And from here the major crossovers or decussions happen. So the cochlear nucleus will always mimic out pathologies similar to the auditory nerve. Ipsilateral pathologies, correct? Whereas in the central auditory pathway mimic out contralateral pathologies, correct? Extra-axial tumors, acoustic neuromas often affect the cochlear nucleus because of the proximity to it. Kernic thrust or hyperbilirubinemia, which is above 15 milligram per deciliter, affects out the cochlear nucleus. So hyperbilirubinemia is always a risk indicator, especially above 15 milligram per deciliter. Okay, now from the cochlear nucleus there is a major decussation. So here you can see three nerve fibers.